Most of the things that we have done in computer graphics till now, it deals with how we can color the objects and what is the methodology adopted in it. So let us discuss a few basic points. First of all, polygon. Let us describe a polygon. Polygon has vertices, that is points in space, either in two dimension or in three dimensions. Polygon is an ordered list of vertices, each vertex connected with the next in the list, last is connected with the first. Because if you want to draw a polygon, the last point must be connected with the first one, that is the most important point that you have to note down in case of polygons. It may contain self-instructions, a surface which is closed one and bounded by a straight line segments is known as a polygon. This is the definition of polygon and you have to note down this definition. The line segments are called edges or sides of the polygon. The point of intersection of the two edges is called the vertex of the polygon. So here if we see and take a look at this particular point, this and this, they are meeting here, this point is called the vertex, vertex, vertex and vertex. These are the edges. So let us describe about the how many types of polygons are there. Polygons are basically four types depending upon the description here, regular polygons. So this is the first one, regular polygon, irregular polygon, convex polygon and concave polygon. So regular polygon, the polygons having equal length of all edges with internal or external angle between any of the two connected edges are the same and also known as regular polygons. So here, this is the most important point, that the length of all the edges with the internal and external angle between any two connected edges are the same. But which is not there in the case of irregular polygons. We have to look at this. Connected edges are the same and having different length of edges. This is the important point that you note down here. In the next case, suppose we are describing with the help of convex polygon, take two points inside the polygon and join these two points by a straight line. If all the points on this line lies inside the polygon, then it is said to be a convex, and then if inverse is there, then it is called as the concave polygon. Now scanline polygon filler algorithm, this is based upon scanline methodology that we have already studied. For each scan line crossing the polygon, the area fill algorithm locates the intersection points of the scan line with the polygon edges. So, what is the basic point here? Locate the intersection points of the scan line with the polygon edges. Scan lines are always vertical, sorry, horizontal, and they are starting from the very first original position to the last position, they go on moving. And we have to find out the point of intersection of the points of the scan line with the polygon edges. These intersection points are then sorted from left to right and then left to right, and corresponding frame buffer positions between each intersection pair are set at a specified fill color. So we have to form the point of intersection and then we have to store somewhere, and that is the location which is called as the sorted edge list. We will be subsequently studying about it. Now if we see here, the scan line is passing through this particular location. If we see here, this particular location is there. It is passing, this is the point of intersection. This is the scan line, it is passing through the polygon. This is the polygon here. And interior pixels along the scan line passing through the polygon area. Now this scan line is passing through this area. So these are the interior pixels, these are all the interior pixels. So all the pixels on this particular scan line will be of the same color, will be colored. So scan line polygon fill algorithm, calculations performed on scan conversions and other graphic algorithms typically take advantage of various coherence properties of a scene that is to be displayed. Now let us try to understand what is introduced by the term coherence. Coherence is simply that it provides one part of a scene are related in some way to the other parts of the scene so that the relationship can be reduced processing. For, now actually coherence means of the same time. So we have to identify the image inside which the properties are the same and one part of the scene are related in some way to the other part of the scene. That means we are trying to identify the regions, that is also called regional coherence, and we are trying to find out which region is related with the other which region, and that is the most important point here. Coherence methods often involve incremental calculations applied along single line or between successive lines. So, next, scanline polygon field algorithm, spatial coherence and scanline coherence. There are two types of coherence here. The adjacent pixels are likely to have the same characteristics. Adjacent pixels, suppose we are talking about say this pixel here, adjacent pixels. So if we talk about this particular pixel, this, these are the adjacent pixels here. Adjacent pixels are likely to have the same characteristic and properties. This property is known as the spatial coherence that we have to note down. Scanline coherence, adjacent pixels on the scanline are likely to have the same characteristics. This is called as scanline coherence. Likewise, as we have seen in the last diagram, in this particular diagram, you can see that the points which are lying on the same scanline will have the same characteristic properties. This is what we have to observe here. So, in the next, we will be going about the scanline polygon field algorithm. Some scanline intersections and polygon vertices require special handling. For example, a scanline passing through the vertex intersects two polygon edges at that position. So, this is the most important point that we have to note down here. Scanline polygon field algorithm, for example, continuation with that. These are the two scanlines which are passing here, scanline y and scanline y dash, and we have to find out the points of intersection, and we have to see which part is to be included into the edge list. The scanline polygon field algorithm, in the case of scanline y, we need to do some additional processing to determine the correct interior points, because we have to find out the interior points from where the color has to start. For example, suppose we talk about this particular pixel around which we have to color, so we have to find out the adjacent points here. We consider the vertex V7, both the edges are on the same size, whereas in the case of vertex V5, both the edges are on the opposite direction. This is the most important point here and out of the previous diagram. This kind of vertices can be traced either in the clockwise, we have to trace in a particular manner. Either we have to follow the clockwise direction or we have to follow the anti-clockwise direction. Scanline field algorithm, if the endpoint y values of the two consecutive edges monotonically increase or decrease, we count the middle vertex as a single intersection point for any scanline passing through that vertex. Otherwise, the two edge intersections can be added to the intersection list here. This is the important point here. The scanline polygon field algorithm, in determining the edge intersection, we can set up an incremental coordinate calculation along any edge by exploiting the fact that the slope of the edge is constant from one scanline to the other scanline. Now, suppose there are two scanlines here. It is striking at this making intersection at this particular point xk yk, and it is making at point xk plus 1 yk plus 1, because this is scanline yk and this is scanline yk plus 1. The slope of the edge is constant for one scanline to the next. Let m denote. Now we have to find out the slope. We already know the slope of a line is given by y2 minus y1 upon x2 minus x1. And since we have already calculated the points, so we can find out the point of intersection. Yk plus 1 minus yk is unity, and xk plus 1 is equals to xk plus 1 by n. Recall that the slope is the ratio of the two integers delta y upon delta x. So incremental calculations of x can be expressed as, so here what is this delta y upon delta x is the slope of the line, and we have to mention it here. It is 1 by this one, since m is delta y upon delta x, this is xk by 1 delta y upon delta x. We have to perform sometimes inside-outside tests. The area filling algorithms and other graphics processing often need to identify the interior regions of the objects. Now, suppose we want to color a particular object, we want to find out the interior points. Now, to identify the interior regions of an object, graphing specs is normally as an odd even method for inside and outside test. We have to perform the outside or inside test for that particular polygon. Odd even rule says that draw a line from any position B to the distant point outside the coordinate, extend the object and counting the number of edges crossing along the line. If the number of polygon edges crossed by this particular line is odd, now we have to note down this particular thing, this is odd. If P is an interior point, else P is an exterior point. We have to note down. Then we have, once we have found out the points, then we have to find the, we have to create a sorted edge list, and this sorted edge list will store the information with respect to the points which have already been visited, and it will also store information which are other points which are pending here. Eliminate horizontal edges. Now why we are eliminating horizontal edges? Because the scan line will just touch the, those positions and we can eliminate them. Add edge to the linked list for the scan line corresponding to the Y lower vertex. Shorten edges if necessary to solve the vertex intersection problem. For each edge entry, store the following: Y upper, the largest value of the Y, because we have to always store the upper Y here. X lower, the intercept that the scan line initial value 1 by m for the for incrementing the value of X. So the next value of X, that is xk plus 1, is equal to xk plus 1 by m. M is the slope of the line here. We have to create an active edge list, construct an active edge list during an conversion. AEL is the linked list of active edges on the concurrent scan line. The active edges are kept sorted by X. The active edges list contains all the edges crossed by that scan line. As we move up, update edges list using the sorted edge table if necessary. Now we have here scan line polygon fill algorithm. We have combined it together. Now we can see here set Y to the smallest Y coordinate and has and Y for the first non-empty bucket. Initialize the AEL to the empty for each scan line. Y repeat copy from the SED bucket Y to the AEL active edge list. Okay, and then Y minimum is equal to Y entering the edges, and then sort the AEL on X and fill in the desired pixel here. And remove AEL and those entries which Y is equal to Y in the max for each non-vertical edges remaining in the AEL up till X. Now boundary fill algorithm. Now let us try to frame an algorithm which will help us in coloring the objects. So boundary fill algorithm and area fill algorithms are very, very popular algorithms here. Now let us discuss the first one, that is the boundary fill algorithm. Start the point inside the region. Start the point inside the region and paint the interior outward towards the boundary. Now suppose this is a point P. We have to start finding the adjacent points to this particular point. This is I am marking it in the dark, and this particular point is 4-way. We have to move from here to here, to this boundary. And we have to note down, see it is the boundary specified by the single color, and fill the algorithm proceeds outward pixel here. This is the most important point here, you have to note down. Until the boundary color is encountered here, and it is useful in the interactive painting packages where interior points are easily selected. And coordinates of the interior points x, y, fill color and then boundary. Let us start discussing this particular thing. We have here the starting from XY, the algorithm tests neighboring pixels to determine whether they are the boundary color. If not, they are painted with the fill color and their neighbors are tested. This process continues and until all pixels up to the boundary have been tested. Now here if we look at here this one, Suppose this is the interior pixel. Here we will find out the adjacent pixels and find out the color, and we'll try to color with these four pixels with this color until we reach up to this particular boundary, and we have already noted down the color of this particular thing. So we can do it in two methods are there. One method is called the four way, another one is called the eight way connected method. Four way means, suppose this is the seed point, we have to color the adjacent pixels four. Now in this particular case, this is the seed pixel 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. These all are the neighboring pixels. This is called as the eight way method of coloring. Now let us see the algorithm here. Boundary fill 4, integer x, integer y. Now what is this integer x, integer y? This is the seed point inside the polygon. Integer fill color. Now we have to give the value of the color in integer format and integer border color. This is the border color. Whatever the color that you want in the border, that is to be also given, because that is the checkpoint here. Integer interior color. So you have to fill the value and get pixel xy interior color. Now you are getting the pixel one by one and then testing it. If interior color not equals to border color and interior color not equals to fill color, then you have to do something like this. So you have to note down, this is the most important point here. You have got the pixel here. XY interior color. What is the color of that particular thing? And set pixel XY. Set color of the pixel to fill particular color. And boundary fill, say x plus 1. Now what do we mean by x plus 1? Suppose this is the pixel here, you are moving towards, positively towards this direction. Now x minus 1 here, in this, you are moving in this direction. And then y plus 1, we are moving in this direction, and y minus 1, we are moving in this direction. So this is the algorithm which you have to note down. This is been mentioned here that it is in the four-way method of filling. Next algorithm is the flood fill algorithm. Sometimes we want to fill an area that is not defined within a single color boundary. We can paint such areas by replacing the specified interior color instead of searching for boundary color value. This approach is called flood fill algorithm. We have to note down this particular thing. This is the most important point here. We can paint such areas by replacing a specified interior color instead of searching for the boundary. So this is the most important point here, replacing this one. So flood fill algorithm, we can start from a specified interior point called the seed point here. This is the seed point, then using a four-way connected or eight-way connected approach, the entire area can be filled by the specified color. So if they have a color which is that of the boundary, then do not consider the pixel. If the color is different than the color pixel with the desired color, the process will be recursive, and when stopped, there is no neighboring pixel which can be colored. So you have to identify which of the pixels is to be colored. Let us see the algorithm, or which is of the type flood fill. Now in this particular flood fill, let me find out the wide flood fill, integer x, integer y, this is the seed point values, integer fill color, integer color that you want to do. So get the pixel color and the interior color. If the color is equal to interior color, then set pixel x, y, put the pixel there. And flood fill x plus 1, x minus 1, x, y plus 1, y minus 1. Now this is based upon the same thing that we have already done in the boundary fill, but there is one particular thing that is different here, interior color. Okay, we have to note down this thing. Now let us see the attributes of the output primitives here. There are few important things we have to note down. A parameter that affects the wave primitive will be displayed. Consider only those attributes that control the basic display properties of the primitives. For example, lines can be dotted or dashed, fat or thin or blue or orange. So we can have different properties. Suppose I want to draw a character of different type. Say suppose I want to write A in a different manner. Suppose I want to draw a line in a dotted dashed manner. So all these fall into the category of how to draw the output primitives. So let us learn few things here. In the case of line attributes, we can have the line type, width and the color. So here line type, width and the color, these are the basic properties line attributes. Let us talk about say type attributes, solid, dotted and dashed. These are the lines that we can see here. The solid line, the dotted lines and the dashed lines which can be generated. And width, suppose we talk about the width properties, specify in pixels and proportion to standard line width. Thicker line can be produced. Suppose you want to draw a thick line, how to draw thick lines, that is also possible by adding extra pixel vertical when m is less than 1, adding extra pixel horizontally when m is greater than m. It is m, m is the value of the slope. Lines have different thickness on the slope, problems with the end of the line and joining the two lines, polygons. Now let us talk about further regarding the width attributes. The problems raised due to different shapes at the end of the line can be solved by adding line and caps. Now at the end of the line can be solved by adding line and caps here. Now these are the end caps here, butt cap, round cap and projecting square cap. So this is a projective square cap, this one, and this is a round cap here, this is a butt cap. Now with butt cap, it is obtained by adjusting the end positions of the line so that the thick line is displayed with square ends perpendicular to the line path specified as slope m, square end of the thick line has slope minus 1 by n, and here this is the type butt cap. Now round cap, it is obtained by adding filled semicircles to each butt cap here. Now these are the filled semicircles. And points are diameter to the line thickness. Now here projecting square cap, in this type we simply extend the line and add butt caps that are positioned one half of the line width beyond the specified end points. This is the projecting square cap. Now width attribute, smoothly connected lines, series of line segments cannot be produced as thick lines using horizontal or vertical pixel spans. Leave pixel gaps at the boundary. Suppose we want to join, how we can join this? Between the line different slopes, where there is a shift from horizontal spans to the vertical spans, there are some methods of smoothly joining the two line segments here. Now let us see how the two lines can be joined. The first one is called the meter join, meter join. And one more D. Extending the outer boundaries. This is the extending the outer boundary here. This is the type of meter join here. And round joint, it is produced by capping the connection between the two segments with a circular boundary whose diameter is equal to the line. So here diameter is equal to the line width. This is the important point you have to note down here, and this type of thing will be there. Then the third one, this is called the bevel joint. Bevel joint is this. Generated by displaying the line segments with the butt caps falling in triangular gaps where the segments meet. Now here this. Okay, so these are the three types of joints that we have seen. Line attributes. Now we will see the next is the color attribute. Colors are represented by color codes which are positive integers. And color information is stored in the frame buffer or in a separate table and use pixel values as index to the color table. Number of color choices depends on the number of bytes available per pixel in the frame buffer. There are two ways to store the color information. One is the direct and another one is called the indirect method. Now let us see the direct method. In the case of direct method, let us see here. Suppose we want to represent a 24 bit color. Suppose for each pixel we use 24 bits. How we can store 8 bits of red and blue per pixel. Each red, green, and blue per pixel. So, 8 bits will be for the R, 8 bits for G, and 8 bits for B. So, total will be 24 bits as shown here. So, if we are using 8 bits for R, there will be 256 shades here, 256 this one, 256 this one. So, for example, here we are showing 255000, which is a pure red color. And if we see 255, if all the values are 255, and it will be called as white light. Suppose we are using only 5 bits, say 5 bits for red, 5 bits for green, and 5 bits for blue, then the video hardware uses the value of the driver RGB, and you can mix the different levels, and you can see R, G, and B will have 5 bits, so we can have 32 values for each. Similarly, in direct method, so we have here what is happening, it is some sort of a pointer to a pointer type method. Here, suppose we are storing only these values here in I. Suppose if I say I is 2 and I refer to the corresponding table, which is called as the lookup table, LUT. LUT stands for lookup table. So in this particular lookup table, say suppose if I value is 2 here, I will refer to this particular table and I will get the values here 255000. The appearance of the displayed characters is controlled by attributes such as font, size, color, and orientation. Attributes can be set both for entire character strings text and for individual characters defined as marker symbols. So, let us have some text attributes. First of all, there is a choice of font typeface, which is set of the characters with a particular design style such as New York, Courier, Helvetica, London, Times New Roman, and various special symbol groups. The characters in a selected font can be displayed with assorted underline styles, solid, dotted, double, boldface, in italics, and in outline or in shadow styles. In continuation, a particular font or an associated style is selected in a fixed program by setting an integer code for the text font parameter TF in the function. So, color settings for displayed text are stored in the system attribute list and used by the procedure that load character definition into the frame buffer. When the character string is to be displayed, the current color is used to set pixel values in the frame buffer corresponding to the character shapes and positions. Now let us see. Let us see how the characters can be designed or something like this. This is the character body. It is showing here. This is the top, bottom, base. This is the character height. Suppose we are designing our own fonts. The point measurements specify the size of the body of the character, but different fonts with the same point specification can have different character size. Okay, depending upon the design or typeface. Now here you can see the kernel. We can see the distance between dot and J, character body, and this is kern. So, the most important point here can have different character size depending upon the design of the typeface. So, this is the important point here. Next is the distance between the bottom line and the top line of the character body is the same for all the characters in a particular size and the typeface, but the body width may vary. The character height is defined as the distance between the baseline and the cap line of the characters. This is most important here. Distance between the baseline and the cap line of the characters. The orientation of for a displayed character string is set up according to the direction of the character up vector in which x and y components are specified. The text is then displayed so that orientation of the characters from baseline to cap line is in the direction up vector. Now suppose we want to italicize. There is a method control I we use, and this is orientation for displayed character string. according to the direction of the character. The direction of the up vector is 45 degree next to the text displayed, as this is the up vector here, this is the slant text. Combination of text path and up vector can be used to text path. Now this is the text path here, direction, it can be down, left, right, up and out direction of the up vector here. So we can have a combination of text path, up vector can be used to display the slanting text, as up vector controls the direction of the text path. The text path can be set right, left. Now this is the right, left, up, down. So we can have up or down here in the text alignment. This attribute specifies how text is to be positioned with respect to the start coordinates. Horizontal alignment is set by assessing the value left, center or right. Vertical alignment is set by assigning the value top, cap, half, base or bottom. So next one, string. Now suppose I have written a particular character, suppose we have text alignment, how the text alignment will be done. This is the top, this is the top, this is the cap and half, base, bottom. This is the center, right and left. This is left, center, right, bottom, base, half, cap. Now within this frame your things will be there, you are typing this and the text alignment will be on this particular parameter. Similarly for the vertical one, if you can see here, on the vertical one we have top, cap, half, base, bottom, left, center and right. Now let us see the area fill operations. The options of filling the defined regions include the choice between the solid color or the pattern fill. Now we can do the solid fill or we can do the pattern fill. Choices, particular colors and patterns, these fill options can be applied to the polygon regions or to the areas defined curve boundaries depending upon the capabilities of the available package. In addition, areas can be painted using various brush styles, colors and transparency parameters. Now next if you see here, these are the fill styles here. So this is hollow since we have not colored it, this is hollow, this is the solid and this is the pattern fill here. So this is the three methods. So we can also say a polygon hollow fill is generated with the line drawing routines as closed polyline. Another value for fill style is hatch. This is the diagonal hatch. This is the cross hatch. Another value for fill style is hatch, which is used to fill an area of the selected hatching patterns, parallel lines or cross lines. Hollow areas are displayed using only the boundary outline with the interior color, same as that of the bump diagonal. Solid fill of region can be accomplished with the scan line procedures. Other fill options include specifications for the edge type, edge width and edge color of a region. These attributes are set independent of the fill style, fill color and they provide for the same options as the line attribute parameters. The pattern fill. The process of filling an area with a rectangular pattern is called the tiling, and rectangular fill patterns are referred to as tiling patterns. And this diagram shows tiling an area from a designed start position. Non-overlapping edges and patterns are laid out to cover all the scan line passing through the defined area. To superimpose a selected pattern on a scan lines, the scan line procedures are to be modified. Beginning from specified start position for the pattern field, the rectangular patterns should be mapped vertically to scan lines between the top and the bottom of field area and horizontally to interior pixel positions, these scan lines. Now we can see that pattern fill here. Now this pattern, suppose this is the particular kind of pattern here, then we are filling it pixel start position, and we can a pattern A superimposed on a parallelogram fill area to produce pattern B here. Combining fill pattern with background pattern using simple replacement methods. So here AND OR, and we can replace it. In the case of solid fill, modify boundary fill and cut fill procedures that are applied. Repaint the area so that fill color is combined with the background colors are referred to as soft fill. Only one use of these fill methods is offered to fill the colors at object borders that have been blurred to anti-alias the edges. Another is to allow repainting of a color area that was originally filled with semi-transparent brush, where the current color is then a mixture of the brush color and the background colors behind the area. In either case, we want the new fill color to have the same variations over the area of the current fill color. So from this particular topic, we have learned how the two basic algorithms, that is the area fill algorithm and boundary fill algorithm and flood fill algorithm. And these are most important algorithms of this particular